Let's go down a list of your accomplishments. Like, because it's so many. I just kind of like want to get it on record.
Uh-oh, there he goes. There he goes.
Tennis. I was a world-ranked tennis player. I was successful in real estate development.
And you're watching a football game here? Oh my God, you're in the huddle.
Yeah.
You know, you're in the huddle.
Acted in movies and television. I want to emphasize, it didn't happen overnight.
But I feel like this house is kind of like a culmination of things.
Oh, it totally has changed everything.
You know what I'm saying?
What is true success?
Yeah.
What is true wealth? Is it just money? No, it's not just money.
Thanks for tuning in, vlog. This is Travis Believes, and I have a very special guest, Dave Austin. He is an extraordinary human being, what I like to consider the number one brain coach in the world. He's done everything from being movies to be a brain coach to some of the most famous and lauded people in the world, to also having Grammy hits, to just being a part of just some of the most amazing and beautiful things that's happened in our history. And I've had a good chance to meet with him and really understand that this is truly an impactful human being. So Dave Austin.
Hey, well, thank you. I'm blessed to have you here, man. Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity just to share, you know, together.
Yeah. Awesome. So I just feel like your story really needs to be told. I feel like it needs to have more light. So I want to ask you, how did you become Dave Austin? How did you become who you are today? Like, what started it all?
You know, what started for me was, you know, my dad was a Navy chaplain. That means that we moved every 2 or 3 years. And I was an athlete. Mm-hmm. And I happened to be gifted, very good athlete. And, you know, in Fullerton, California, I was a superstar in football and baseball and everything. We moved to North Carolina, had a new coach, and the coach said, "You're slow as molasses." I'm like, "Oh, what happened to me? I used to be quick in Southern California." Yeah. You know, and I started going and looking over my shoulder when I was running the ball, who's going to catch me? Things I hadn't even thought of. So I was letting a coach tell me who I was in life, letting the world tell me who I was rather than telling the world who I was. Mm. So even at 10 years old, I'm thinking, it's got to be more. I got to be able to be who I am in any kind of environment. So it just started at a very young age of that journey and traveling. And then we moved to Hawaii. My dad got stationed there. And luckily, I overheard the coaches saying, "Hey, that new Austin kid, he's kind of fast." I went, "I'm quick here. Thank you, God. I don't know how I got here." But I just, you know, and I had even put on weight because I looked at myself differently. Then I shed all the weight, going, "Oh, okay." And I thought, wow, how powerful is our mind?
Yeah.
Even at a young age. So I went on, you know, to get a football scholarship, baseball scholarship, and you know, just start thriving in that. And then I got in a horrendous car accident where I was actually killed in the accident. And I don't really talk about it normally. I don't know if I ever told you this.
No, I don't think so.
So I had an experience that, you know, most people don't have, I hope most people don't have to have, but it changed my life forever. Yeah. But to rehabilitate myself, because it looked like I'd never walk again, I started playing tennis. Wow. I transferred down to San Diego State. I've always been such an athlete. I just love to go after things fully. And after I got learning how to walk again and that, I went in, you know, here I had a scholarship for football and baseball. I was a walk-on in tennis, but I've learned that if you go 100% in no matter what, and you're willing to take failure and just keep falling forward, anything can happen. Well, I went on to have, you know, a very successful career and then went on the tour and got a world ranking and, you know, kind of crazy. But
what was your world ranking?
It was down there. It was world ranking.
Hey, it's better than me. I can say that.
You know, but here's the funny thing about my world ranking. So, yeah, it was pretty low. It was, you know, well, not one of the top guys. But 8 years after I retired, learning more and more, even though I had a degree in psychology out of college, it was like traveling the world. I really dove in to understand things fuller while I started coaching, because I always felt like that's where I wanted to be, a positive coach. Well, if you can't do it to yourself, you know, you're just pretty hypocritical. But I got invited 8 years after I retired to go to play a tournament in Canada. All expense paid. Kathy and I didn't have kids yet. Now we have four boys, as you know.
Yeah.
But, you know what, let's go. You know, it's been 8 years, but, you know, let's just go. Not only did I get to the finals, in the finals, I beat the number one team in the world.
Oh, wow.
Won the tournament. And I'm like going, okay, there is a lot of stuff to this medal cert. So if I can do it, then I just have to understand how I can relate to other people to rise into it.
So, you know, got to keep yourself in shape, right? Once an athlete, always an athlete. And, you know, these things, you look out at the beauty as you work out, and we have the TV over there for games and, you know, stuff. So, this has it all for us. Mm. You know, with COVID, I did belong to a gym, but we stopped going to the gym and decided to create our own gym.
That's the smart thing to do.
And it's been awesome. I mean, I've really been, you know, this is a speed bag. So Roger Anthony, who is my partner, could do this better than anyone in the world. He did amazing things, but I can't even come close to do it like him. Oh, we gotta pump it up a little bit.
There he goes.
And then this, hold on. I do this with some of my athletes because there's a mental focus that has to take place. You can't think. And it helps them, believe it or not, baseball players become better hitters.
Yeah, let me try it.
That's what we're talking about!
I always knew I wanted to be a coach, but that's not what I started out with. I played professional tennis, and that gave me opportunities to be in movies and television. And then I had a record on the radio, mm-hmm. as you know, and yeah. Picket and Billboard and all that stuff. But again, it's devotion into going. I knew that even though I start off not very good at it, if I put everything into it, I can allow myself to rise into it. And then I surrounded myself with great artists. You know, like I did things to where, like when I performed live, I had Santana, I had Kansas drummer, I had Journey, my favorite band, playing guitar. I mean, I was able to work it so that I kept expanding.
Yeah.
So I went from pretty low to really high.
Yeah.
But I found that anybody can do this in life. I'm not unique. It's just when you make a commitment behind something and you understand that that commitment gives you the ability, even when you're afraid to do it, even if you're like, oh, I don't know how I'm going to do this, you step through what I call now, actually, Henry David Thoreau was the one that first said it, is that you step through an invisible barrier where new universal laws are available. So when you look at me now and you go, okay, you know, I've been in top line movies, been on television, had a hit on the radio, written three best-selling books. What else? You know, I've been a world-ranked tennis player. I've had a chance to speak all over the world, Harvard, at the UN, at the Global Summit, in India, at the Women's World Wellness Congress, in Uzbekistan. All that comes from understanding some principles that I just dove into. Like, and you know what? Jesus was the greatest mental performance coach of all time. If you look at the Beatitudes, he spoke in Aramaic. Now, when the Bible was written, it was done in Greek, and there aren't language that you know, words. But if you go back to Aramaic, you go, oh my God, this is a roadmap. You can achieve anything by just following that. And then you look at a guy like Henry David Thoreau. Now, see, I've gone to Israel. I've gone to where Jesus spoke the Sermon on the Mount. So you get in that energy. And then, you know, like Henry David Thoreau out of Concord. I've been there. I've been where he wrote in Emerson. And you know, Thoreau said, if you walk confidently, to your dreams. You'll meet an invisible barrier. And if you've got the courage, because most people get a little freaked out, you're able to pass through that invisible barrier where new universal laws are available. Very yeah. tied in, if you think yeah. about it, back to what Jesus said about healing, right? Yeah. So all of a sudden, I went, huh. So it hasn't come overnight, I'll be honest, like anything. I constantly get quiet, I say. You know, back to Emerson, he said, if you want true wisdom, take a walk in the woods. Einstein said, I didn't have a bigger brain, I had a better connection.
This is the most fun room.
It's the entertainment room.
This is so much fun. Being competitive, right? Come on, I'll take you on ping pong right now.
No, you can't beat me. You wanna go game?
You wanna go? Well, I gotta see. You know,
let's go 2 points.
Okay. You know my thumbs. I can't use my thumbs, so let me see how you go. I was skiing, you know, a few days ago, and you know I took a.
I don't want to hear the excuses now.
Yeah. Well, I just gotta match. I'm so competitive. Yeah, I can
come
do
on.
It. I can do it. I can do
come
it.
Up. Come
I can
on.
Do it. Come on. We'll come on. Give me something.
Let's go. Let's go.
Come on.
Okay. 4-3. My way. Whoa.
Okay. The point of the match. You want to serve or you want me to?
You. Oh! Oh! Good one.
But I use this too for executive retreat. You know, we have the grand room downstairs, but this patio is big in the summertime and everything. We have umbrellas and it's really spectacular.
Yeah, yeah.
And you know, we have kitchen here and everything too. I think we have more dishwashers in this house than we've ever had in our lives.
Let's go down a list of your accomplishments, like, because it's so many. I just kind of like want to get it on record. Like, let's start from the beginning. You were ranked in tennis.
I was a world ranked tennis player. I was successful in real estate development until, and that's a whole nother story. But I acted in movies and television. I was the first guy, believe it or not, Diet Coke when it came out. I was the on-camera guy for Diet Coke.
Oh, wow.
So I did a lot of TV commercials. I was lucky with that. We talked about the record on the radio, which almost caused an accident. I'm driving along the freeway. You got to have an experience there where you go, yeah. Whoa, that's, you know.
And I hear your record on the radio yeah, for the first time.
I had to pull off the freeway and just kind of rock out with it. It was really exciting. And then when it showed up in Billboard as a pick hit, it was like, it was mind-boggling. Yeah. But that, again, I want to emphasize, it didn't happen overnight. I didn't start like, oh, I just have this magic.
There is no such thing as overnight success.
I worked it. So I had that. I put on the first, what was called the Music and Tennis Festival, which Phil Ehart, who founded the rock group Kansas, and the music world said, it'll never happen. I remember the heads of labels said, it will never happen because the musician's not going to donate their time. We ended up with every major act. I mean, it was amazing. It blew the music world out of the world. In fact, Queen showed up even. And that was, they weren't even on our list. They showed up. I'm on the stage. This is a funny story. This guy comes up and goes, hey, we want to go on. I said, get out of here. What are you doing back here? And I had to introduce, you know, Santana or whoever. I just, Loverboy, who had the number one hit at the time. It went on and on. Commodores, you name it. It was hits all night. And finally, I went to Phil. I said, this guy keeps bugging me. He wants to go on. I said, can you get him out of here? How do you get backstage? He goes, put him on. I said, what do you mean put him on? He says, it's Queen. I'm going, oh, Jesus. It was Roger Taylor who was the one that was, and he's a drummer. And I didn't know what their drummer looked like. And I went, oh, let's put him on. You know, so it just, it changed the course of the world for music. So then we just did it every year. And then Live Aid happened. And then the Grammys came to me and said, hey, would you put on, we want to start the Grammy Foundation. I said, well, you guys know how to put on a concert.
You won a Grammy, right?
No. I got the Presidential Merit Award from the Grammys.
Tell me about that.
Well, because of what we did in the music world of creating the space for musicians to, you know, nowadays, look at it. When we need help, what happens? The music world steps up.
Yeah.
Universal, the head of Universal at the time, then asked me if I would run a label with Universal. So I've had experience running a label too, which is an interesting experience.
Elevator, take you to the different stories. But let's walk. Let's go down to... Now these are... The only problem is they're the most comfortable chairs on the planet.
So you go to sleep.
So you go to sleep, and so you have to be really get used to it. I could never stay awake for our movies.
Yeah, that's pretty cool, man. That is really cool.
And you're watching a football game here? Oh my God, you're in the huddle.
Yeah.
You know, you're in the huddle. It's amazing.
Yeah. Now this is. What are you guys doing for Super Bowl?
Well, that's what we used to always put on a Super Bowl party, yeah. But you'll see other places. We have all the TVs all around the house are all interconnected. Oh. So we'll have the Super Bowl on everywhere and we'll go to the game room. So here we'll watch it, the game room, and there's food everywhere.
Oh,
it's a fun thing. This is a guest suite also. But we use it right now for our massages. And Christmas present wrapping, that table's not usually here. So yeah, it's a little bit different, but this is, it's got its own little kitchen. It's even got its own staircase there. So we had our chef live here. And so that she has her outside, garage and everything. Mm-hmm. Now we've turned that two-car garage under this into, a gym. We call this house the Love Shack because our first chef came here and she had just gone through a divorce, but while she was living here, she fell in love and now she lives with him. And then our second chef who came was about 8 months and she was separated from her husband, where her husband and her were able to
reconcile.
Yeah. And then our gal who cleaned the house and everything stayed in this guest house. And she found the love of her life. So
Wow. We
call in this house the Love Shack. And so, I don't know if we'll get a new chef or not.
Wow. All right, so I kind of wanted to hinge on this point. I wanted this point to land. So your son was born 8 weeks early. He was premature. They didn't think he was going to make it through the night. And so I'm assuming he has some sort of disability, correct?
Yeah. I mean, he was in special ed. And I don't know, when it all took place, it was really interesting because when I showed up, I had to fly back from Omaha. Kathy was in the emergency room. I, got there and the doctors pulled me on the hallway and said, your wife doesn't understand. She doesn't get it. This is serious, very serious for her life, and the baby doesn't have a chance. And I just said, guys, we got this. And they're like, look, they thought we were crazy, but we were crazy because we had surrendered. When I say surrender, I don't mean surrender to loss. We surrendered, there's going to be victory in this. If he's disabled, if he's can't do things or whatever, then you know what? It is what it is. But we had this belief that he was going to live. And so, so many miracles. I mean, it's all in the book. Day after day, a new miracle took place. After 5 days, a doctor comes in and goes, look, it's all good, but we're going to take all the life support off because we don't think a baby should be on a life support their whole life.
Yeah.
Where that, you know what? We don't either. Take it off. They go, well, you know what that means, right? I said, yeah, another miracle. That wasn't what he meant.
Right.
But, and so Daniel has been so special and we're so blessed.
The name of your son.
Huh? Daniel. Yeah. He is so special. He has such impact on people. And the cool part is he gets to live with us always. We have three other older brothers and they all move on and that, but Daniel still needs us.
So you never let the disability take away from anything in terms of him accomplishing what he wants to accomplish, what you want to accomplish. It just doesn't stop anything.
It never stops anything. He's my sidekick. He's inspired. I'll give you an amazing inspirational story.
He's inspired some of your success.
Right, so I'm at spring training with the Los Angeles Dodgers. Alex Cora is our second baseman. David Roberts is our center fielder, mm-hmm. right? Now managers of Boston and now you get the connection of the Dodgers, right?
Amazing.
So I'm at spring training and I'm dressing the team and they're all bitching and complaining. Like, we didn't get a hitter in the offseason. I'm looking at them going, you know what? If we went out and got a hitter,
that was the best in baseball. He'd be as crappy as all of you are right now with this attitude. He'd come in this locker room and, you know, I mean, why don't we just, this is kind of strange, but I come off of my, you know, where I'm inspired to say, I said, stare into the eyes of the guy next to you until we find the hitter we're looking for. And we had Beltre in the room. We had great hitters, but they were all not taking responsibility for who they were. I just had to tap them into the gifts that they have. Let's bring them out fully. And then I ended up telling the Daniel story. And I said, when we come back after spring training, we go in the locker room, I'm going to bring Daniel in. He was 5 at the time. I said, you really want to know what a champion looks like? Look into his eyes and you'll find a champion. Alex Cora grabbed Daniel, looked in his eyes, and it's just the first time I brought him in. And he's like, and he goes out, and if you Google Dodger history, 5 greatest moments in Dodger history, mm-hmm. that was the day that Alex Cora fouled off 18 pitches, or 17, I can't remember if it was 18 or 19, and then hit a home run to win the game.
Wow. That's amazing.
Yeah, that's amazing. Yeah. But Daniel has had that on a lot of my athletes. Ryan Braun, who was the MVP, one time on the field, I had him, you know, it's just, there's something to Daniel. And I could go on and on, but that day with Ryan, that day, and it was funny, I told my brother who I'd taken down on the field for his birthday, well, you know, what do you give your brother? Well, take him down on the field before a game. It's kind of cool with his son. I said, watch what happens to Ryan tonight now that this whole connection with Daniel has happened.
So,
well, real quick.
Yeah.
First time home run, second time home run, third time home run. In San Diego, where before they moved the fences, and supposedly I can't hit home runs there. And I thought, well, gee, it is special. My brother was like, oh, you're kidding me. Well, Reggie Jackson had already hit 4 home runs in a game, so it had been done. So what does Ryan do the fourth time up? Hits a triple. Wow. No one had ever hit 3 home runs and a triple.
Dang.
So it just, I could tell you on and on, Daniel has something about it, that there's a spark to him. This is another one of our rooms. Again, each one of these, they all have walk-in closets. They all have, the walk-in closet, beautiful bathrooms, and then, patio. You know, I want everyone to be able to experience the outside.
Yeah. Yeah, no, it's pretty cool, man.
This is our little, call it meditation prayer room.
Meditation, yoga, all that room, huh?
Yeah. Pretty cool. And, you know, you saw we had the secret panic room, right?
Yep.
Guess what? Maybe you have to do it from the other side. This is a secret passage. Okay. So again,
I stayed in the other rooms.
Two rooms. So, see that right there?
This is a secret passage.
That's the secret passage.
Yeah.
Goes into the little library.
And then that goes to your room, right?
Yeah, well, I have to check with Kathy before we do
that.
Is
she in there?
Well, hold on. Yeah, but this is a cool room you want to talk about inspiration? You know, you might be can you see all this, how this is?
Yeah, I like that ladder. It's like a little library study.
Yeah. Area. If you look at the books I'm reading, you'll see right now, I kind of get off on ancient wisdom type thing, and I read stuff from way back in the past and find the connections to now.
Yeah.
It's like there's some amazing material that they knew this stuff then.
They did?
Right.
And they studied more.
Yeah, it was like, yeah. I guess we didn't have all the distractions.
Yeah, right. We're so distracted by so much now, we don't, you know.
You know, I mean, think of what Thoreau did. He went out on Walden Pond to do a personal experiment. 2 years, 2 months, 2 days, 2 hours, living in the woods on the Walden Pond. And so when you read him, it's, you know, I have to say you have to be at a certain kind of openness to understand what he's saying. I haven't always been there, but the more that I've kind of opened up, I now read and go, oh, this is good stuff, you know, because he was just in that environment. Same thing with Emerson, you know, it's like, wow. And then I start seeing the connections going way back then.
Yeah.
You know, all the way back to, like I say, in Aramaic, when you read some of the things that how Jesus spoke, it's like, oh man, there's such a richness here. This is so cool.
Yeah.
There's more here than we even know.
Right. Yeah. I feel like
and you let me know if I'm wrong, but I feel like this house is kind of like the culmination of things.
Oh, it totally has changed everything.
You know what I'm saying?
You know, I say it many times as I've been on the doorstep before of true success. And mm-hmm. success is a lot of things. What is true success?
Yeah.
What is true wealth? Is it just money? No, it's not just money. It's a combination of love and joy. Wealth, yeah, that's important, but it's not the number one thing. And this home, when we came here, I had a knowing that this is where we were to do our work. But, you know, we have such an amazing place here. But it was been a vision in my mind for years. Took longer than I thought to manifest. Maybe I had to pass enough barriers finally to come through. But this house represents faith. It represents trust. It represents, even when it looks like there's no way, I kept being reminded of Daniel. Impossible, medically impossible. Well, if that's capable to go past medically impossible to live, then what barriers do I have financially?
Wow, another lesson being taught there. You know what I'm saying? So, no, that's powerful. So, yeah, like I said, I feel like this house is kind of like a culmination of things, kind of like a final frontier in terms of planting, like you going from one level to the next level, not only from a physical standpoint of your home, but just from a mental standpoint. And as you just said, that, you know, the experience with your son actually kind of like was that hurdle that you had to overcome mentally. And then once you were there, this was like nothing for you.
Yeah, I was.
So this is like a manifestation,
right,
of that mental, you know, challenge life that you overcame.
Right. You know, when you have a life and death challenge, right?
Yeah.
It changes everything. And I kept being reminded when I said, I don't know how I'm going to do this.
Yeah.
Well, did you know how you were going to do that? You listened to me before. Are you going to listen to me now?
Yeah.
That takes such, it took me to a new level of faith and trust and prayer. And, you know, but then you have to be surrendered too into, like, if it doesn't happen, you don't have to go, oh, I'm devastated.
Right.
It just didn't happen. But I keep getting, this is where you're to do your work. Think of what we've done at this home. Think of the fundraisers we put on at this home. Think of the workshops I've done with executives at this home, at leaders, you know, that we've done. It's such an incredible environment. Most people, if they feel energy, it's kind of funny. You do. So, you know, when you walk down here, you go, whoa, I feel something.
Yeah.
And it's just here. But we knew that. And we knew this home was beyond a home.
It was
more to help people come here. A lot of my private clients, I'll have them stay in our two-bedroom cabin, which is, you know, it's just down here.
Yeah.
And it's just so cool to be here in this environment. So half my work's done.
Yeah.
I can go, okay, now you're open. Let's roll.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So as you know, my wife, oh, wait, where are you going? So this is where Kathy does most of her writing.
Yeah, I can see.
This is, you know, by the fireplace.
Book comes out next year.
And then you got the guest house and the cabin and the barn. But the best thing is, the best part of this whole house is just walking in the woods.
Yeah.
I haven't seen it
though. And normally, isn't this funny how close it is to our house? And most of the time, you can't even see it from the house.
I know.
Because of the trees. You didn't even know it existed.
I didn't.
You know, so
when
we have people come and stay, they're like, they think they're in the mountain retreats. Well, it is like that.
Yeah.
And then the whole backside's a pond and there's a waterfall.
This is just like beyond cool.
Jacuzzi? Why not? You know? Let's get some lights on. But look at this. No, come here though, just for your own look. Yeah, the other stuff, you know, it's got its washer and dryer, you know, here. This is all generally a pond here, the waterfall's here. You don't see any neighbors.
Oh, what's this up here, man?
What's that? A little yeah.
It's like a little attic, huh?
Anyway,
that's pretty cool, man.
So this is where we have the pizza, you know, wood burning, you know, pizza stove.
Yeah.
I think it's the best pizza I've ever had. It's
really?
Crazy in our own house.
Might be a little biased, man. Might be a little biased.
Well, I no,
but I'm just joking with you.
I think I'd be biased the other way. I think
just with you.
I know, but I think I was pleasantly surprised. We have, which is really cool. Heated. Notice how this is all, you know, all the snow. There's no snow here. There's snow everywhere else. See back there. So all this is underground heated.
Mm.
So that
Again, I'd like to take credit for it, but it was all here when we bought the house. Can't take credit for any of it.
This was amazing, Dave. This was a beautiful tour. This was a more expansive tour than even the first time.
I walked to that door and I looked at the realtor and I said, don't show me anything else. This is the home we're gonna buy. Don't know how I'm gonna do it, but we're gonna do it.
Yeah.
And you know, most realtors would run at that point. You don't know how you're gonna do it. But you know, I just know and I have faith, and like healing, like Daniel, or healing Rincon, takes a deep level of faith and trust, and every day practicing getting quiet and listening, what do I do today?
Yeah.
What's my practice today that will move me forward in a better light?
Improve every single day.
That's it. That's it. Every day.
That's the lesson. I think we're going to end on that one.
Okay, cool.
That's it. If you have one last piece of gem, though, that you want to share with the world, what would it be? One last piece of gem.
Well, it kind of goes with everything we're saying. And again, I get a little bit biblical here, right?
What's personal to you?
It's done unto you as you believe. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that seems like a simple statement, right? But everything, it really is your belief system that shapes completely your reality. So if you believe this is possible, it's possible. If you don't, it's not. And so as I've gone deeper and deeper into that, how do I keep creating a bigger, better belief system? Mm. It's not something you can just think about. You know, I talked about all the invisible barriers that who put them up? I did. It blocked me from my greatest good. But if I keep moving forward, my belief system supports all the kind of craziness that's happening for us in a very good way.
That coincides 100% with what I believe. So I named myself Travis Believes. That's my name.
Oh, I love it. There it is.
And because I believe your belief system and what you believe, what you tell yourself every day, is even more important than what you know. Because there's a difference between knowing the path and walking the path.
Right.
And what you walk is based upon what you believe.
Exactly.